What was that? Good Saturday morning, everyone. Welcome to another great edition of the Roundtable. For everyone joining us here on the WJSQ, WLR Facebook page, we're going to have a great program this morning talking about the McMinn County Historical Society. I'm waiting to go live on the radio, so just kind of bear with us as we get set up here.
Photogenic.
You look pretty good. Good Saturday morning, everyone. Welcome to join another great edition of the Roundtable here on this mid-sunshine morning here. And if you are listening right now on the radio and you want to watch this live, you can join us on the WJSQ, WLAR Facebook page, where we are live and taking audience participation this morning. We'll get right off and introduce my special guest this morning. I have Fred Underdown, the president of the McMinn County Historical Society. Fred, thank you for joining us this morning.
Well, thank you for inviting me, Eric. I really appreciate it. Because like you said, we're with the McMinn County Historical Society, and we're probably the best kept secret in town. People don't even know that we exist, but we are, and we have been around for over 30 years. So if you're looking for something like when your parents were married, your grandparents were married, or like come down and visit us, we're in the courthouse in the lower level, as they call it now. We call it the basement for a while, but they said, no, it's the lower level, it's not the basement. So come on down and see us.
So as we get started, we'll talk more about that as you're in the lower level, not the basement, of the courthouse. As we start off here, Fred, for people that don't know who you are and what you do for the Historical Society, just give a little bit of information and background about yourself.
Well, let's start with a little bit about the Historical Society. The Historical Society is it's a 501(c) corporation, which means it's a nonprofit organization. It has no employees and all volunteers. Myself, I'm a retired businessman, retired back down here. I'm from McMinn County. I'm fifth generation McMinn County. My family came here back in 36, and so my family's been involved in the community. And when I first went into the courthouse one time and seen something where my grandfather had written something, I thought, oh, wow, that's cool. So I got involved with the courthouse and with the Historical Society. I got involved with McMinn County and its people. That was back in the early 90s. And it's still something that's very popular. So if you want to know what's where and where it's at, come on down and see us.
Absolutely. And again, that's in the lower part of the McMinn County Courthouse, not the basement. Fred, you know, as we talk about some of the things that people would want to see, what's a process if someone has something of historic value and they want to give it to the Historical Society? What's a process they do to get that involved for you guys?
Well, first of all, we're interested in documents, pictures, stories, something that's written, family Bibles we take pictures of. We're not a depository for artifacts. You know, that goes to the museum, and that's okay. What we want to see there. But if you have letters, and there are original letters around here that just sort of amaze me, that go back into the 1800s that somebody wrote from maybe the Civil War era that they wrote home, and all of a sudden they appear. So those are the things that we're interested in. We're interested in people giving us their yearbooks from McMinn High School or college books, and if they can identify the people so we can see those people. We're interested in those church directories also. But documents that we have, we go back to 1819 in documents. Marriage licenses we have. We have the wills of the people who are there. And if they died intestate, we have the records of what they owned. So we have that. We have the land information about who was the first founding fathers. And we're getting ready for our 200th anniversary, as you well know. And we're going to start a new program called the Pioneers of McMinn County, and we'd like to get those people that were in the first 21 years of the county to do their history and become one of the pioneers. So that's something that we're really looking forward to.
That'll be great. But what are some of the services and benefits? You mentioned just a few there, that you some of the historical documents you keep. What are some of the services and benefits that are provided in the historical side there?
Well, that's the biggest, that we are we take care of all of those documents, or try to take care of, be good stewards and keeping track of the documents, keeping them safe, and we some of the documents that we have are not duplicated anyplace else, anywhere. So they are one of a kind. We have writings of people like Walker and Ross and McMinn and John Sevier and Van Dyke and Geddes. And I don't know if any of those names mean anything to you, but there are very significant people in history. The Starr family. So we have those documents that are there that you can come in and you can trace your history. You know, it'd be cool to find out what something that your grandfather did or your grandmother or that, their family. And in my case, one of the coolest things I found is that I had some relatives that were crazy. And, you know, I found out that I resemble those quite well. So I always thought that was sort of funny when I found that.
I'm going to skip ahead because we're talking about some of the stuff you've got in there. One of the things that's intrigued me and always intrigues a lot of people here, Battle of Athens. And when I came to visit you, you've got a great display set up in there for the Battle of Athens. Let's talk a little bit about that as we go through. What's some of the historical things that you have stored within there that kind of gives meaning to that time? Because the reason I ask you, I always see people asking, where can I see displays of this?
Yeah. Well, the Battle of Athens is one of the unique things of our history of the United States. And you know, it's the only time that the people took up arms against the elected officials and held them hostage, if you will. But some of the things we have original letters that was written. We have a lot of that information that's there. We have all the newspapers that are there. We have stories that was written by the people that were there at the time. People like Prof. Powers. People that wrote some of the stories was Steve Byram's book is probably the best known one. Bill White's story, and Bill White's got his family has continued to have a Facebook page for him. There's been three stories or movies that's been produced. The one I like the best is the one that we propagate, and it's called Home to War.
Yes.
It was on the History Channel, and you had the opportunity to view that.
Yes, I've got a good copy of that. That's and that's available there in your
only from us.
Only from us.
Okay, so
that's good to know. If you get a chance, definitely go pick that up. That whole play essentially is what it is, written out. It gives you first count event of the people there. Now, as me and Fred talked about, there's some takes in there that are not from that time, but it's a great movie for you to see about the Battle of Athens.
Well, it was narrated by David Keith.
Yes.
And Bill Landry, if you're not familiar with him, he's got many Emmys sitting in his house from his program in East Tennessee and the histories of East Tennessee.
Most people remember him from the Heartland series.
Absolutely.
With WBR. He always produced a great series of that.
Oh, yeah.
So how many documents do you estimate that's sitting preserved within the Historical Society in the lower level there?
Well, you know, in the lower level there. when I seen that question that you put on there, I just started thinking about it. And, you know, it's thousands. You know, you think about pieces of paper 200 years old. And we have thousands of those pieces of paper. We have most of them are bound. They're in books. And, you know, these books are that big, you know, this thick, that wide. So, you know, I couldn't even put a number to it. I went in there and said, okay, so there's 500 pages in that one. And we got, two divided by fourth, then 9 times 10. You know, thousands is about what I can say. If you want to come down there and count them, come on down and help me out, and we'll start counting the
books. There you go. As you talk about people coming down, if they want to inspect, is there any fees involved or anything like that, or do they have to have certain time frames they want a copy of a document?
Well, we have a phone number, which we'll give at the end of the program,
okay.
I think. But we try to be open, like I said before, we're totally volunteer. We try to be open from 9 to 1, Monday through Friday. And we've been pretty successful at doing that. Every now and then, we're getting into the summer months, so we suggest that you call ahead of time to make sure, but there is no cost for the documents. If you want to make big copies of things and that kind of thing, we're there for you. We'll help you out as much as we can. Yesterday we had some people in from Oklahoma. Day before that, or a couple days before that, we had people in from Texas. We've had people in from just about every state, wow. And they come in to do their genealogy, because when you look at our names, this was the gateway to the West. And you'll see these names all the way from here to Arkansas to Missouri, Indiana, Illinois, Texas, big time Texas.
Wow.
We took 40 people out to Texas 2 years ago that the Texans paid for, by the way. the GTT trip, which meant going to Texas and back here in Tennessee. They used to put GTT on their doors, meaning going to Texas. And then the people from Texas came back, and if you get the opportunity, go up to Maryville and look at the statue of Sam Houston, who is a very interesting historical person. President of another country, governor of two states, has a very impressive thing. And the people from Texas come back here to their roots. So
check everything out.
Check it out. Find out who was where and when. And people want to go and stand on the land that their grandfather owned,
yes.
Or great-grandfather said, wow, isn't this fantastic? That's where they live. You know, that's the hill that he talked about. Being Mountain is something just happened yesterday. It's sort of interesting. Is there's Star Mountain, then there's Being Mountain.
Yeah.
And some of the legal descriptions say that you can see Being Mountain from their property. And there's a large contingency of the Being family that wants to go stand on that bridge and be able to see their mountain. So, and then the Star people are unbelievable too. So.
That's a great information right there. All available to pick up downtown Athens there at the lower level. Have you guys got any special events or programs that are coming up that are related to the society while it's summertime for people to check out?
Well, what we're in the midst of planning, what we're going to have is running a genealogy thing for people to come in. And we're thinking we're going to be doing this on a Thursday night. With people with computers and come in, and we're going to show you how to find your genealogy, how to find those people that's in your background, what tools to use, and while we can help you. We do have access to the internet, but most of those, we want you to have the documents so that you can see some of that and where it came from. And that's what we're going to be pushing for. We ran one of these about 6 years ago,
yeah.
And it was really popular. People came in and wanted to know, where do I start? And the first thing we tell them is that start with what you know. Start with yourself, your wife, if you're married, your children, if you have children, go to your parents, and then just work back from there. And talk to the people, the older people, while they're alive, because they're tough to talk to once they're dead. They're really tough to talk to.
That would make it hard, just a little bit. So this event that you're planning, is there any cost for anyone to come to be a part of this?
Yes, there will be. There'll be about a $20 fee for materials. There'll be a book that's given to you that has all the information in it, the things that you want, like the census forms. The census forms change from census to census. And the census that we're all very interested in is the 1850 census, and that's the census where it lists everybody in the family. Prior to that, it only listed the head of household. In our 1850 census, we have a copy of it that was by Reba Bayless Boyer. Hope that name's familiar to a lot of you. But she was the matriarch of the Historical Society, if you will. She wrote a lot of books. She was born in Indian Territory in Oklahoma. And she came back here she was just a dynamo. And in her census book, she wrote things like who your mother's maiden name was. Maybe things like, when the census was taken, the cousins would visit you. And they said, no, this child belongs to this other family over here. And she got all these personal notes that she has in there. And one of the things she did for me, I might add, and I have to add this, I did not know they had sex operations back in 1850. And you probably didn't either.
I did not know that.
Well, my great-great-grandmother was my grandfather had died, and she was listed in the census as Frank Underdown. Male. And she was Frances Underdown, female, and she's the one that showed me that in the census book, or says, oh, well, they made a mistake. And that's the kind of mistakes that they do make occasionally And thankful for me, I was happy to find out that, that I had a grandmother and not two grandfathers.
So as we talked about your event that's coming on, we talked about a specific time and date. What's the phone number and, again, the address for people that want to come and be involved in this genealogy test in Charlotte?
We're going to have it at the courthouse. And if the front of the courthouse is the one with the big columns in front. And when you're standing there in front of the courthouse, you look to the right, and there's a ramp that goes downstairs, access for handicap. You go in those doors down there, and we're the first office on the right-hand side. And we'll be having that in the blue room downstairs is where we'll have it. And the phone number to call is 744-3911. We'll repeat that one more time.
Go right ahead.
Okay. 744-3911. Call us, come on down, see us. We'd be more than happy to share what we know. And we have some people, the people that are there are very devoted to things. One young man that's from Riceville, Jason Wright, is really knowledgeable about the area, but he's really knowledgeable about military things. We have another person, excuse me, from Englewood, who has been all over the world doing digs and that kind of thing. And that's and she is really, really good at some of the local history. That's Virginia. She's there, and she can help you. She's usually there on Wednesdays. We have somebody that's really knowledgeable about the Indians, the Cherokee, and that kind of thing. And that's Janice Cantrell. Interesting story about her. She's from Oklahoma, too. But the Cantrell name is familiar to everyone.
Yes.
And she moved here about 5 years ago now, and they bought a place down on County Road 750. And when we mentioned to them that the Cantrells were around here, she says, well, my husband's not related to any of those. Well, where she lives at, you can stand in her front yard and look where Cantrell Farm was at back in the 1800s. Her husband was related to those Cantrells. And her husband has embraced the area, and he, the Cantrell Revolutionary Soldier, has one of the most interesting graves markers that you'll ever see. It looks like a sword. It looks like a handle at the top of it. It looks like the tip of the blade at the bottom of it that sticks up in the air.
Yeah.
And then a flat portion looks like the blade. And that's at Williamsburg Cemetery.
Wow.
Over in Etowah. So if you haven't ever seen something like that, that's really cool to see.
I'll have to check that out. Yeah. I'm usually over there in Etowah. Good deal. So I'll check it out. So you mentioned the internet earlier. Let's talk a little bit about that. Have you guys got a website where people can start their search?
Well, the answer to that question is no.
Okay.
We have websites, and that's sort of an interesting thing, and you may have run into this. People started websites that had nothing to do with the Historical Society and said that they were. And then there was one that we did have, and unfortunately, we don't have control over it. So the answer to that question is no.
No website.
No. But we do have a Facebook page, and okay. we do post on that, Nightman County Historical Society. You'll see things on there. We have a meeting every, through the fall, from October to May, we have meetings that we film and put on there. And you're all welcome to come down the first Sunday of the month at 2 o'clock in the afternoon to come to our programs. Look for them in the paper or on other media, excuse me. And then we have some very, very interesting programs coming up for next year for our 200th anniversary. So come down and join us.
Most definitely. With your social media page, do you guys post a lot on there talking about different parts of historical significance in the area?
Yes, we do.
Very good.
Buildings. Yesterday I had the opportunity. Well, yesterday I was from Crossville to Murphy. You know, that's sort of the little area that I was in looking for. And we took some pictures of some log cabins in the area. Now, people don't realize that these log cabins are covered up with clapboard boards, but if you see a door jam, when you go in the front door that's about this wide, it's a log cabin. You know, if it's an old house. So we was taking some pictures of those and want to try to make those be survivors. We want people to try to take hold of those things and keep those and not lose that history too.
Very good. As we wrap up the program again, I'm going to give you one last opportunity here, phone number and address for anyone listening on the radio or watching us on social media today to come find you guys.
Well, in the lower level of the courthouse.
Stress the lower level. It's not the basement.
Not the basement, the lower level. It's the phone number is 744-3911. But something I think everybody should be aware of. These documents that we have, we've been trying to preserve them. And it's very expensive to preserve them. We need an environment that is humidity controlled. And we are experiencing some problems, as they are in all document areas, it seems like, is that we've developed a mold that's called foxing, which deteriorates the records. And we're trying to get enough monies ahead to get those documents so that they don't deteriorate. Eventually, they'll just fall apart if we don't do something. And we're trying to get them duplicated. Not all records that we have that are of a historical value are other places. We may have the one and only copy. And we'd like to get them duplicated. Yeah. And that's expensive to do. The state will do some of them, but they don't like to take things that are mold environment. And getting somebody to come in and do that is very expensive to do. But before those records disappear totally, come down and touch some of those records and see where your great-great-grandmother got married and find out something about your family, the property you own, or something that I seen back yesterday. I seen something the museum put up about Grant University or the Red Elephant Hotel.
Yeah.
Come on down and see that. We've got a beautiful color picture of that thing that used to set up on Woodward Avenue. And we've got pictures of the Geddes farm, the Fisher families and stuff like this that you've heard about, you've been around all your life, but you didn't really realize that there was things around that you could see and pick and touch and feel.
It's a great opportunity to see our history right there, right at the lower level of McMinn County. So if you mentioned that it's expensive, do you guys take donations? If someone wants to, from the public that's listening to the radio or watching us on social media, wants to make a donation to help you guys out, where do they need to come and who do they need to make it payable to?
Well, make it payable to the McMinn County Historical Society. Come down to our office and we'll give you a receipt for it, so it's tax deductible. We receive no monies from this. Everybody thinks we receive money from the county, which I think is sort of interesting, and we don't. We don't receive a thing from the county, and we're not big enough to really go out and try to get have somebody on staff to write and try to get donations.
Grants and such.
Grants. And it's really interesting to me that I'm going to say this in a jealous mode, I guess. The Historical Society down in Calhoun in Charleston averaged $75,000 a year in grant money. And McMinn County's Historical Society has gotten zip in the last 5 years. So
that makes it rough.
That makes it rough. And the people that are there, from Janet Cantrell to Mary Ellen Noletti to Bill Bingham, who owns the Mexi Wings, these people are there and they take out of their own pocket to buy a lot of these things. A lot of the books that are there now, that we reference books and so forth, we pay for. I bought and paid for maps of the area. And not to even think about the time that you spend there. But I don't regret one iota. It's just I really thoroughly enjoy it.
It's a great place of wealth of information for people to find.
Yes, it is.
Fred, I want to thank you for coming on the program this morning talking about the Historical Society. You guys check it out, downtown Athens, lower level of the McMinn County Courthouse. One more time with that phone number there, Fred.
744-3911.
Check him out. Go down there and check out some of the great artifacts that they've got. Learn a little bit more about the information in the area. Get your genealogy taken care of. Find out where you came from. It's a great opportunity. With that being said, that concludes the roundtable for this Saturday morning. You can join the roundtable every Saturday morning at 9 a.m. You can also see this replay of it on the WJSQ WLAR Facebook page. The radio portion does replay every Sunday morning on WJSQ 101.7, our sister station. Next Saturday morning, my special guest will be Durant Tulloch. He is the director of the Etowah Chamber of Commerce. He'll be on to talk about some of the things they've got going on over in Etowah and what his chamber is doing to help the area over there. We want to thank you all for tuning in, and we'll see you next Saturday morning.